the when the prices goes up, since it's not an essential thing, you forego the luxury. You give away the luxury and settle down for something else. So if you are dealing with luxury products, increasing the price might give you a bad result. That is what you have to understand. I am just giving you these examples, these explanations, for you to understand how to meddle with the thing, how to deal with the market. Alright? Given goods, or else you can call it as inferior goods. What are these? Economic genius. What are given goods? What are inferior goods, rather? Yes? Don't say that you have done economics or anything. I will always question you. What are given goods? Or rather, given is a name of the person who has defined this thing, right? So, inferior goods. What do you understand by inferior goods? Price and quality is generally lower than a normal particular product. You have to compare that with a normal product, normal goods, and then come to an understanding what different goods are. Different goods are generally low in price, low in quality. So why do you do that? Why do you go behind them? Who will go behind you? You have to think. If you know that a particular product is low in quality as well as low in price, why do you buy that? Who will buy that? Or are they? Sorry? Lower caste. Lower class people, or rather, people with low level of income. People who cannot fulfill, cannot go for essential goods, who are struggling with their lives, will go for this. Right? When the income levels are rising, when the income levels are going up, what will happen to the demand of given goods? It will go down. Alright, Veblen goods, what are these? Veblen goods, once again it's a kind of a general definition. I'll tell you this, Veblen goods are no way useful for life. Then why do you have those goods? It only has a... Now we will come to this. Co-product, secondary product and the augmented product. When I say Veblen goods are no way useful for the life of your living. So which means it might not have a co-product. What is it? What does it have? Augmented product only. What are those? Sorry? Mind you, that's an essential goods. Those will fall under essential goods. You have to have some box. For me, there won't be anything. I'll tell you now, there won't be any funerals for me. So there won't be any box for me. So therefore, in general, that's an essential good. Correct. That's correct. I'll give you the proper example. Say diamonds. Diamonds. Diamonds are extremely high price. We do not know the quality of the diamonds, right? So what is the product in diamond? It's augmented product. For what do you need a diamond? You want to eat that? No. You just have to show your wealth. It's a way of showing your wealth. Right? So Veblen goods, you can always mention the example as diamonds. Why did I say correct for the designer goods? Designer brands. There is a co-product in designer brands as well. So it goes a little bit wavered with this particular definition. But you don't need a designer brand to live. Why we buy a designer brand is to show your wealth, show your craft. Alright? So the diamond, it, as I told you, it doesn't really fit into this particular definition, yet it is a Veblen good. Alright, understand? Mind you, the demand curve of a Veblen good goes the other way. When the price increases, you demand more. If you get a diamond for 10 rupees, would you buy that? No way. The diamond has to be at least 10 million. Proper diamond has to be at least 10 million, 20 million. Small diamond, small piece of glass or something like that, right? If you get it for 10 rupees, would you buy that? No. How can you show your wealth from 10 rupees? There's no way. If the designer brand, Giorgio Armani or something like that, if you get it for 250 rupees, would you buy that? No way. You are not going to buy it. If you are going to get a Rolex for 2000 rupees, you doubt about that. You think whether this is a fake thing. Of course, it could be a fake thing. You don't buy it. Right? Consumer goods. These two, I have to tell you that in general, these are two categories which are categorizing the goods in an economy into two. No, this is a different story altogether. This doesn't fall into the law of demand. It goes the other way of the law of the demand, which means the price, when the price increases, the demand increases. When there is a diamond for 10 million, there may be 20, 30 people, top businessmen are coming behind that, right? And if it is 100 million, there may be 30, 40, all the foreign guys are also coming behind this. Thinking, that's a very good diamond. That is how it is. The great paintings like Mona Lisa. Who cares about Mona Lisa? Only these people, right? Who are going behind Veblen. Do you think any beauty behind that? Maybe. But people are going behind that not because of the beauty of Mona Lisa. The painting itself is it's a Veblen product. Alright. Any problem? No. Now, these two categories, we are going to forget about everything, consumer goods and capital goods. The whole economy, the total production of a country will be divided into two. Right? So, what are consumer goods? Consumer goods are the goods which will be produced for the purpose of consumption. For the purpose of consumption. Capital goods are the goods which will be produced for the purpose of producing another product. kind of a machine, right? When you are thinking of the apparel field, a shirt is a consumer good, machine is a capital, right? So why this category coming in? To understand an economy in a country, if you have more capital goods, you have the capability of producing more consumer goods. If you are going to invest in a country, all the resources of a country on consumer goods, which means the next year you can't produce anything else, right? Okay, it's a kind of a tedious explanation on all the goods. You have to understand where you stand, right? Where you are going to fit in, you are going to get fitted in as a marketeer, and you have to understand what are the items that your company is dealing with. If your company deals with consumer goods only, your target market is the consumers, end users, right? Capital goods, if your company is producing machinery or something like that, which will help to make another product, these products we call as industrial goods or capital goods. We call it industrial marketing, right? So mind you, your customer base is quite different. Here the people, industrialists who are buying these goods, they are well versed about what they are going to buy. As a marketer, you cannot just easily come and sell the goods. Now say, how many of you have seen these direct marketing fellows who are barging into your houses, direct marketing? Sir, just sir, you don't have to buy, sir, we just came to show it to you, sir, and is that and the other consumer products. Can they ever sell capital goods? No. There's no way that they can sell capital goods because they are trying to just talk and some or other put the goods through and run out. Right? Okay. Do you understand this or not? Any question? No problem. Now try to understand this. You have seen this. You? Yeah. What is demand function? Demand is dependent on the price of that particular product, prices of other goods, which means the substitutes and the complementary goods, income of the customers, taste of the customers, population of the country, population in the market, technology. All these aspects will have an impact on demand, will have a positive or negative influence on demand, right? What do you mean by taste? Now your industry, you are into what? Apparels. Taste is what? Taste for the fashion, right? You are in the fashion industry, right? Our module is defined as fashion and textile marketing. So you are into fashion, Taste. What you have to understand is taste is always changing. So if you are in the market of taste, you always have to think of the dynamism of the market. You can't say, these were the things that we were selling those days and we were very happy and all the customers were happy. Now we are going to continue this particular trend for another 100 years. You can't do that. Technology. If you are into the technological product, you have to change yourself. even within 4 or 5 months you have to change. See how many phones that are coming in, how many computers that are coming in, how any electronic gadget, it always changes with the technology. Population. If the population is more, the demand is more. That is why people say China and India are big markets. Why? They have big amount of, huge amount of people. What's the population in China? I know that you are not responsible for that, but what's the population in China? 1.5 billion, 1,005 million people, 1,500 million people. India, 1.2, 1,200 million. Where do we stand? 1 billion, 21 million. So, in comparison to markets like India and China, we are nowhere. Right? That doesn't mean anything. Right? I'm not asking you to produce like that. Okay? So, you think of Singapore, you think of Sweden, you think of Australia. Australia, what's the population? 21 million or 20 million, it's almost the same. Sweden, 8 million. Denmark, 4 million. But the level of the countries, the level of production that they do, they are far ahead than us. How many, what's the rank in economy? When you compare to the world in Sri Lanka, what's the rank? We are the 78th, I suppose. There are more than 78 countries, right? 78. So Sweden, they fall among the first 15, right? So when you are thinking of the market opportunities, you have to think of the population as well. If you have a big population with a great taste, of course you are there, right? As I told you that today it's almost an economic class, right? We'll try to understand what this is. Elasticity of demand. I was talking little bit earlier about. Elasticity means the flexibility. Flexibility towards what? Price. Cross, I'll come to that. And income. Elasticity means the dynamism towards the price. If the price increases by 10%, if the demand goes down more than 10%, you call it elastic product. Tell me, what are those products? Of course, luxury goods, right? Then the price goes up by 10%. Then the demand goes down by 20% or 30%, then that means the particular product is having a price elasticity. It's an elastic product. As per the price, the demand goes wrong like So what is the inelastic, what are the inelastic products? Essential goods. Electricity. Cigarettes. Who are the smokers here? Who are the smokers? No, you are not babies, I know that. And neither I. Not that I am a smoker. Who are the smokers here? Who are the smokers? No one. No, I thought you raised your hands. Mind you that the smokers What's the price of a cigarette? 60 rupees. 60 rupees. Oh. Hell. So, out of the 60, yeah. Out of the 60 rupees, you are paying 83% to the government as taxes. 83% to the government as taxes. So, great contributor to the economy, right? Do you think cigarettes are elastic or inelastic? Elastic. Who says elastic? No, nobody. Who says inelastic? Middle. Inelastic. Why? There's an inferior product to cigarettes, right? There's an inferior product to cigarettes, different goods to cigarettes. What is that? BD. So now, we will come back to the cigarette business, right? Cigarettes are almost perfect inelastic. What do you mean by perfect inelastic? Which means the demand curve goes like this. However much the price goes up, the quantity remains the same. This is perfect inelasticity. That's an hypothetical situation. There's nothing like that. So these particular cigarettes are like this, almost inelastic. Why? However much the price goes up, smokers slowly shift into the same quantity. Right? Liquor is almost the same, inelastic. Right? Petrol, diesel, all those fuel. And when you define a product in a broader manner, that goes to the inelastic position. See, transport. Transport is needed, that's an essential product. You say train transport or vehicle transport, that's a different story. That's a subdivision of transport. When you define it broadly, it falls under inelastic position. Food is essential. You don't need a meal from a 5-star hotel. That doesn't fall into that category. Right? So when you define it in a broader manner, certainly it will fall under inelastic in price. Cross elasticity. What is that? Do you understand this price elasticity? Elasticity means changes in demand. As per income. That is what I'm trying to say. Cross elasticity means substitute products and the complementary products. Which means cross, this particular product, say product A and product B. B is the substitute. Prices of the substitute will affect the particular product A. Prices of the substitute will affect how much, how elastic, how dynamic it is. That is what you call by the cross elasticity. Say, prices of the coffee goes up, how much it will affect the tea? If prices of coffee goes down, how much that will affect tea? Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola and Kick-Cola, there's another one, Coca-Cola and Cha-Cola, Champa-Cola, right? even the complementary goods, when the petrol prices goes up, how it will get affected to cars? That's a complementary good, cross elasticity, which means it is elastic towards the other product's price. Alright, don't get confused. Income elasticity, which means how dynamic the particular product as per the income of a customer. Essential goods, is it elastic or inelastic? It is inelastic. It is inelastic as per the income, even with the price of the product. If you are dealing with essential goods, you have to have less effort in marketing. However much you try to sell, it is inelastic. However much you try to reduce the price, the quantity will be almost the same. Right? Got it? So when you think of advertising, who will advertise more? You have to always now, you are becoming different people after this marketing sessions. You look for advertisements, TV advertisements, radio advertisements, paper advertisements. Who are these people who are advertising? Are they advertising essential goods? Right? No. Generally low. Right? So you have to go behind these things. Because we will come to advertising later. Right? So income elasticity is how do you consider with inferior goods or given goods? How do you consider that? When the income increases, think of people who are using inferior goods. Why do they do that? Because of their low income levels. If the income increases, what will happen? They will shift for better products, normal goods, which means it has a higher elasticity towards income, not the price. This BD example, right? If you are a diehard smoker and if you don't have money, you somehow or other find something and smoke, right? Nothing to do with the pricing. Some or other you smoke, right? And your income levels goes up, you act like you have never seen a BD. Right? Okay? Is this printout clear for you? Is this printing clear or what? Is it all right? You can manage? Or else I can send this PowerPoint presentation to the leaders and you can distribute, right? You let me know whether you need it or not. Now we are going to talk about the markets. How these markets are being formed. Now we were talking about demand. In the earlier slides we were talking about demand and how it behaves and what are the products and all sorts of things, right? The elasticity and other things. This is something to do with the demand or supply. Customers or suppliers. These are formation of suppliers. How they have organized themselves, how they have positioned themselves. This is something to do with the producers or suppliers? Yeah, you may ask a question to fulfill. How do you define a market? You become something as a market is you have to have a supplier, you have to have a buyer or customer, and there should be some goods and services. So those are there, right? This is the way that any economy, the suppliers are getting organized. Right? From where should I start? Perfect competition or monopoly, or shall I start from the middle, or what? What do you prefer? We talk about monopoly. Monopoly. What does that word mean? Mono means what? Mono means single. Mono means single. Monopoly means, and we are talking about the suppliers, huh? We are talking about the producers. How many producers are there? Only one. One producer. Is it a good situation or bad situation? Bad. Good. Very nice, huh? Some say bad, some say good. Why it is good? You are talking about from the point of view of the supplier. Okay. From the point of view of the supplier, he is saying monopoly is good because there is no competition. You don't have to worry about it. You are the only fellow who said bad. You said bad. Why it is bad? You are talking about the customer's point of view. Customer's point of view is bad. Why? Only one supplier. You have no any other option. Whether you like it or not, you have to go for that. In USA, basically monopolies are not being allowed. The government get involved and say, no, you can't run like this. Do we have monopolies in Sri Lanka? What are those? What is it? Tobacco farm. Okay. What else? So, tobacco company, the smokers, you don't have option. You have to get whatever they are selling. You have to get at whatever the price they are selling, whatever the quality, whether there is a strike or not. You have to starve, right? Okay, what else? Railway. You were talking about this earlier, right? Electric board. Petroleum. Now, IOC is there, but IOC is having 10% of the thing, but even petroleum corporation is giving it to them, right? So monopolies are not good from the customer's point of view. The thing is, any company, any producer will have a profit. Is it good or bad? Is it good or bad? It is all right. It is all right to have profit because otherwise they can't survive. Monopolies is having something called supernormal profit. We can prove that with some graphs, graphical, I don't want to go up to that level, right? What you have to understand is that they are having something, they are enjoying something called supernormal profit, which means beyond the normal profit. Obviously, because they are the only institution that they are supplying a particular product or products, right? They are dictating terms on customers. Whether they like it or not, they have to buy. Then we'll come to this oligopoly. What is that? Oligopoly. Oligopoly means there are a handful of suppliers, few suppliers, 2, 3, 4, 5, something like that. And they have an agreement amongst them on the pricing and the supply quantities. Say there are 5 suppliers. They work together. They get together, kind of an association. And they say, okay, this is the price. This is the quality that we are going to maintain. So, no customer can prefer who the supplier is. And this is how much that you are going to sell. Can I have an example for an oligopoly? What is it?
Oil.
Oil in the sense, not everywhere. Who is the biggest producer of oil in the world?
Huh?
Sorry?
Excel.
I can't
Excel.
No, that's a company. I'm asking the countries.
America?
Saudi Arabia. Hmm? Who said Saudi Arabia? You? Who's agreeing with him? I'm asking the biggest producer of oil in the world.
Russia.
Who said Russia?
You.
Russia is the biggest biggest producer. Biggest export in the world is Saudi Arabia. So the Middle Eastern countries, they are the exporters, because Russian production is not enough for them, right? The Middle Eastern countries, they got together and they are manipulating the crude oil auction. They have a quota system amongst them, Kuwait, UAE and all sorts of countries, with a price, the price and the quantity they decide. So world has to take it. So that's an oligopoly, which means they are trying to create a monopoly by getting together with several suppliers. Got it? Understand, right? Okay. Then I'll jump here. This is what you call the perfect competition. It's completely contrast, completely opposite of monopoly. What is the perfect competition? Which means there are a lot of suppliers who are competing in a perfect manner. So therefore, there are how many suppliers here? Unlimited number of suppliers, unlimited number of customers, right? Large number of customers, large number of suppliers. They are dealing with homogeneous products. What are those? I have told you sometime back. Homogeneous products. What is that? Almost all the suppliers are producing same similar kind of product. Quality, the looks, the price, everything is almost the same. Can we have an example here? In Sri Lanka, how the Sri Lankan apparel market is sort of organized? Are we dealing with brands, or are we a supplier to a brand? Are we a subcontract? We are a subcontract. So, no, that's not perfect, because when, say, for an example, Victoria's Secret wanted to have few suppliers, they say that these are the measurements, these are the specifications and the material to be used, and you have to produce and give. You are just doing a subcontract job. You are not doing any designing, any kind of branding or anything like that. other apparel market is quite different, right? So perfect competition is what? Large number of suppliers for a particular product or a service, large number of